We're living in the darkest of times, and it's going to get darker. And you need to stand on the Word of God, not on what you have been taught and not what the churches have taught. Today, the churches have failed. But I'm glad today that God has a remnant that are rising up. Some of you watching me may be among those remnant, and God is raising you up to do what He's called you to do. Lay anything down that distracts you from drawing closer to God and getting where you need to be so He can use you like He planned even before you were born. I hope you have your Bibles, that you turn with me to 2 Kings chapter 5, and I will begin reading. Now Naaman was captain of the host of the king of Syria. He was a great man with his master and honorable, because by him the Lord gave deliverance or victory unto Syria. Naaman was also a mighty man in valor. He could fight, and he wasn't afraid to do it. He wasn't a coward. He was brave. Naaman was a man of valor, but he had a problem. He was a leper. Leprosy in that day would eat your flesh, eat off your fingers and toes, your ears, your nose. It would eat you until you died, and there was no cure for it. And this Naaman, who was captain of the host for the king of Syria, had some leprosy on him that would not go away and would continue to grow. But I believe he covered it up, and because of who and what he was, the king put him as commander-in-chief over all of his army. He was a mighty man, the Bible says, because the Lord was with him. I want to tell you something today. You ain't nothing without the Lord. You may have certificates on your wall in your office, Pastor. You may have an associate degree, a bachelor's degree, a master's degree, and it sickens me when preachers insist on being called doctor somebody. Doctor ought to be held to medicine only, that you can help people that are sick. But to hear a preacher who calls himself doctor, it's a Pharisee in my book. It's not a position of honor, but to be called a name, to open a door for you. You are nothing without the Lord. You can say it. You can even try to do it, but you will fail. You have failed. You're failing because you're doing it, what you're doing, without God. Too many people make a plan and ask God to bless their plan. That's not the way you do it. You ask God what He would have you to do, and then you do all you can to obey God's plan, and then you let God take up the slack in your life. Naaman, right here in the Bible, had leprosy, but it did not stop him from doing what the king and the nation of Syria needed him to do. They needed a military leader, and because the Lord was with him, he brought victory to his king and to his nation. Would to God we had someone like that, that stood with and stood by America instead of their medals, instead of their ribbons, instead of their rank. Some of you generals, you've looked down your nose on non-commissioned officers and people of low grade in your world. You've looked down your nose at them. Many of them are a better man than you are or ever will be. Shame on you, colonels and captains and majors, when you can command a ship, but you can't get a prayer through to God because you're trying to do it on your own in your flesh. God have mercy on you. I hope you humble yourself and pray and go before God and say, "Oh God, what have I done? What have I done?" Don't you know that God is no respecter of persons? God don't care what rank you have. God don't care where you buy your clothes. For years, I have bought my clothes at Goodwill because they were cheap and I could afford them. They were good clothes that somebody else had the privilege of wearing them new. But I was not ashamed to wear them used. Some of you preachers are wearing $500,000 suits, wearing $300, $400 pair of shoes, a $50, $100 necktie, and you're nothing without God. You're nothing without Jesus. You're nothing without the anointing of the Holy Ghost that makes a difference. When are you going to get it through your hard head? God is not impressed with your gold and with your silver. He's not impressed with the buildings that you have burdened the people with to build and go into debt for the next 20, 30 years. That's why He closed them. That's why He's going to keep them closed. The Bible says God's people perish for a lack of knowledge. It's a very polite way of saying they ain't got no sense. Back to 2 Kings chapter 5. Naaman had a problem. He was a leper, but God used him. No matter what your problem today, maybe you can't see good. Maybe you can't hear good. Maybe your speech is not the best. That's all right. Let God use you like you are, and then God will add His anointing in you and make it work. All God's looking for is vessels that are broken and contrite, the Bible says. He loves a man of a broken and a contrite spirit. Briefly, I can recall times when I was the pastor of churches and I would fast and pray and seek God, what God wanted me to do with the church that I was trusted with. And on one event, the Lord spoke to me and said, you need to fast. Some of you have never done that, but the Lord spoke to me and said, Eddie Paul, you need to fast for 40 days and 40 nights. No food. All I drank was water. I denied myself coffee. I went on that for 40 days, and during those 40 days, the Lord spoke to me that I was to get on my face in my office 4 hours every day for 40 days, praying and reading my Bible and seeking His face. It was hard. So on the 1st of February, I started a 40-day fast, and in 40 days, I think I lost 35 pounds. I looked sick. You could see my ribs. Can't see them now, but you could then. I was adjunct chaplain of Gaston Memorial Hospital right out of Gastonia, North Carolina. I continued my duties as pastor. I continued my duties as a chaplain at the hospital. I continued my duties in the community church organization that fed the hungry. I did all that I normally did, except I spent 4 hours every morning from 6 to 10 a.m. on my face, in my office, before the Lord, just as He asked me to. And after 40 days of fasting and praying, I really felt like God would come down and miracles would pour out and my church would have revival. And oh, I was expecting great things. So after 40 days, I asked the Lord, I said, now what? And the Lord spoke to my heart and said, you've got sin in the church. And I thought, I already knew that. I'm the pastor. I know I've got sin in my church. What do you want me to do? You know what He said? He said, deal with it. Too many pastors sweep it under the rug. Too many pastors pass the buck. Say, let God take care of it. Well, pastor, you're supposed to be the voice of God. You're supposed to be in the place of God for your church. You're supposed to speak for God. You're supposed to have a heart for God. But because you dress yourself up in fancy clothes and shoes and drive fancy cars and want money in your wallet, you don't have the Holy Ghost to do the work of God in your church. You don't have the backbone to say in the pulpit what you need to say, or to say one-on-one in private what you, the voice of God, should say. But I remember I started going to people in my church, talking to them face to face, telling them what was wrong according to the Bible and what they needed to do. And guess what? My church got upset and fired me. 40 days of fasting and praying and seeking the face of God, and my church fired me. They picked up the phone, called the officials, and said, we need a new preacher. And the officials got them a new preacher, moved me on to another church, then took me away from that one, because I have determined to seek the face of God and find out what His will is, whether it pleases men or not, is irrelevant. You're supposed to please God. The Apostle Paul tells us, you can't please God and man, and that's why the church has failed. That's why the church, as we know it in buildings, is failing, because too many people in authority are trying to please the people to keep their presence and their money. They think by having a bigger church with more people and more money and a fancier building for the community to look at, that God has got to be pleased with that. Hogwash! God is not pleased. God is pleased when you give all that you've got for one soul. Did not Jesus say that He was willing to leave the 99 to go out and find just one? Preacher, pastor, let me ask you, how many people in your church got saved since January this year, 2020? How many of you led to Jesus? Or are you just stroking the folks so they'll keep coming? I'm telling you, God's sick of it. Here we're walking into the days of the return of Christ and multitudes are not ready because the church has failed. Now Naaman, captain of the king's guard, commander-in-chief, verse 2, 2 Kings 5 and 2, and the Syrians had gone out by companies and had brought away captive out of the land of Israel a little maid, and she waited on Naaman's wife. Naaman's wife had a little Jewish girl who was a servant in her house. And by living in Naaman's house, the little girl knew that Naaman had leprosy. And verse 3, and she said unto her mistress, now listen to this, she was a servant, she was a captive, was not free to go back home, but she said to her mistress, would God, my Lord, were with the prophet that is in Samaria, for he would recover him or heal him of his leprosy. That little girl had compassion and care for her master, Naaman. Verse 4, and one went in, apparently somebody overheard what was going on, and went told the king. And one went in and told his lord, saying, thus and thus saith the maid that is the hand of Israel. And the king of Syria said, go and I will send a letter unto the king of Israel. And he departed and took with him, listen to this, 10 talents. And the king sent 10 talents of silver and 6,000 pieces of gold and 10 changes of raiment. And he brought the letter, Naaman brought the letter to the king of Israel, saying, Now the king sent a letter to the other king in Israel, saying, now when this letter is come unto thee, behold, I have therewith sent Naaman, my servant, to you, that you may heal him, recover him of his leprosy. 10 talents of silver, 6,000 pieces of gold. Here, I'm giving you the money. Heal my servant. And it came to pass, verse 7, when the king of Israel had read the letter, he tore his clothes and said, am I a God to kill and to make alive, that this man doth send unto me to heal a man of leprosy? Wherefore, consider, I pray you, he seeketh a quarrel against the king of Israel. Said, what are you trying to do? Pick a fight with me? I'm not a God. I can't heal this man of leprosy, even though you give me all the silver and gold. I want to tell you something today, preacher. God cannot be bought. God is not impressed with your silver or your gold, your church and its fancy stained glass windows and carpet and chandeliers and total living centers that you put your people in debt for. They'll never get out of debt because of you. It's selfish on your part and pride that you would do such a thing when you need to focus on souls. Have you not read that God is going to judge the earth and destroy it by fire? All these churches are going to burn. Everything that man has made is going to burn. And the only thing that's going to survive it is those in whom the Spirit of God dwells. Verse 8, and it was so when Elisha, the man of God, had heard that the king of Israel had rent his clothes, that he sent to the king, saying, wherefore hast thou rent thy clothes? Why did you tear your clothes, king? Why did you tear your clothes? Let Naaman come to me, and he shall know that there is a prophet in Israel. I want to tell you something. There are some real prophets out there. More of them are false prophets. Don't take me wrong. There's a lot of false prophets out there. Jesus warned us of them, that they're after your money and your stuff. They're after fame and fortune. But God is exposing them. Have you not seen the news lately? And I'm not going to call any names. I pray for these people. God have mercy on these great leaders of the church movement today that are resigning, that are going on sabbaticals, that are stepping down because they're being exposed. $1 million preachers are being exposed. So Naaman in verse 9 came with his horses and with his chariot and stood at the door of the house of Elisha. So when Naaman realized that the king of Israel couldn't help him, even though he offered him the silver and gold, he came to Elisha. 2 Kings 5 and 10, and Elisha sent a messenger unto him, saying, hey, Elisha didn't come out to him. That's what he expected, because he was a man of honor. And Elisha sent a messenger unto him, saying, go and wash in the Jordan River 7 times, and thy flesh shall come again to thee, and thou shalt be clean. Doesn't sound too hard to do. Turn yourself around, go back to the Jordan River, and dip in it 7 times, and you'll be clean. the leprosy will go away. But look at verse 11. Doesn't it sound like people? Verse 11, and Naaman was wroth and went away and said, behold, I thought he would surely come out to me and stand and call on the name of his Lord and strike his hand over the place and recover the leper. Are not Abana and Pharpar rivers of Damascus better than all the waters of Israel? May I not wash in them and be clean? So he turned and went away in a rage. Naaman, the commander-in-chief of the armies of Syria, was angry that he had come with silver and gold to get his healing. I want to tell you something. You can't pay God enough to get your healing. You can't pay God enough to get your miracle. You've got to come before God in humility and know that nothing you have is he in need of except for your heart. God wants your heart. And if God gets your heart, he'll have all the rest of you. One of the reasons why God doesn't have your heart is because you're not willing to give him everything else with it. You want to hold on to your silver, your gold, your house, your car, your job, your plaques on the wall. Preacher, take the plaques off the wall and say it according to the word of God that without him, I'm nothing. All those certificates, whatever they cost you. Some of them I know, God knows, you bought them. You didn't earn them. You bought them. And some of these colleges give out honorary doctorate degrees to preachers and other people to make the college look better. Foolishness in the eyes of God. Too many have believed it. That's why the church has failed. Preacher, you need to stay on your knees and fast and pray until you're forgiven and filled with the Holy Ghost. You need to be filled with the Holy Ghost. That's what it takes to do the work of God. I want more of him. He gives me joy and peace and helps me sleep good. My head barely touches the pillow and I'm gone. I don't go hungry. I'm blessed because my desire is more of him, not of this world. For all that the world can give you will perish. When Naaman's servants told Naaman all he had to do was do the simple thing the man of God told him to do, Naaman, thank God, humbled himself, went down to the Jordan River. He dipped once and nothing happened. He dipped twice and nothing happened. Three times, four times, five times, six times and nothing happened. Then went he down and dipped himself seven times in the Jordan according to the saying of the man of God. And his flesh came again like unto the flesh of a little child, and he was clean. He was clean. He did what the man of God asked him to do, and God performed a miracle and cleaned his uncleanable flesh. I'm challenging you. You want God to do something for you, then I'm going to ask you in Jesus' name, what is it that God has asked you to do? What has God asked you to give up, to give? Do you have three cars in the driveway and you don't need but two? Do you have two cars in the driveway? You don't need but one. Have you got clothes in your closet that somebody else would be glad to wear? What do you have that as a test God wants you to give? Have you not read the scripture? He who sows sparingly shall receive sparingly. He who sows bountifully will reap bountifully. The Bible says, God is not mocked, for whatsoever a man soweth, that shall he also reap. Maybe you haven't gotten answers to prayer. Maybe you haven't gotten your miracles. Maybe you haven't got your healing because you've not obeyed God. Hopefully, you'll hear his word, act on it, and open the door between you and God so God can do things in your life that you need. You don't need a building to find God. All you need is a place to pray. If you have to go to your room, you have to shut yourself up in a basement, in the attic, you might need to go sit in your car and shut the door so you can cry out to God and nobody hears you or you're not bothered by it. But he says, call upon me and I will answer.